So I'm Jamie Cooper. I'm a doctor who became an intensive care physician, and I've done clinical research right back from the very beginning for a number of very good reasons, I think. One is because it makes life way more interesting and way more exciting, and it makes me think about everything I do when I'm looking after the patients, the critically ill patients in the ICU. And secondly, it's because I know that a lot of what we do, and a remarkable amount of what we do when we treat patients, has never been tested properly in well-designed clinical research trials. And when we do it, almost always we find new things and unexpected stuff that can lead to change practice. Clinical research is the only research that can lead directly, if it's good enough, if it's accepted enough, and if it translates, as Steve has been saying, and it's translatable, it's the only research that can change what doctors do. Doctors can be very resistant to change their practice, and so the very best, the randomised controlled trials in patients, the difficult ones, but the best ones, are the ones which really impact and lead to change. So when I'm in the ICU during the day, looking after patients, me and the people who are working with me are often thinking about what are we doing now, how would we do that better? And if we were going to try and do it better, how would we design a project that would enable us to do that? And there are so many things that one could do and one could improve. And what I'm going to do in the 5 minutes that I've got to give you some interest in this topic is to really only show you two things. I want to show you two examples of projects and trials which were run and initiated and managed from this AMREP campus, which involved collaborators and sites all around our country and internationally, and which led to very high impact publications and changes in practice. So very briefly, the first one is a neurosurgical operation where they take a piece of bone out of the skull. Neurosurgeons, like in this picture, have been doing this for 8,000 years or more. And they, like the current neurosurgeons, knew that if you took a bit of bone out, you could reduce the pressure in the brain. So if you survived the operation, and if the reduction in pressure was a good thing, then it might improve outcomes. Now, it just turns out that patients in the ICU who've had a brain injury from trauma and are on life support often have swelling of the brain. So neurosurgeons have translated the knowledge from this slide into that knowledge and developed a new modern operation where the brain pressure could be reduced, and it appeared to improve outcome in patients. It had been studied in not very high quality clinical trials for many years, and it was increasing in practice throughout the world because surgeons and intensivists felt that it was a good thing. We decided that this had never been studied properly and we needed to test it. So we did this trial. We wanted to know if reducing the pressure in people with swollen brains would improve their outcomes. And what we found was, first, sure enough, it did reduce the pressure and it reduced the time in the ICU. So it seemed like a good thing. But because we did a very careful randomised control study in a difficult environment and we measured the patient outcomes in the long term up to 6 months and we did it carefully, we found that in fact, despite the reduction in pressure, there were more severely disabled and vegetative survivors and there were fewer people with independent living in the long term. And this was a dramatic and unexpected finding for neurosurgeons and turned on their head a lot of their ideas about reducing pressure in the brain. What were the right pressures to do it? What was going to be the safe ways to do it? And what about this procedure? Furthermore, it was published in the New England Journal, which is the highest impact medical journal in the world. So it came out of the AMREP campus. We got collaborators from every site, every other trauma centre around Australia and some international, and it was published in the biggest American journal. So this is how you really impact practice. It's by going straight into the journal clubs of all the hospitals internationally and having people talk about it and decide what's good, what's bad, AMREP must be good. And in several other big journals, this particular finding was recognised because somebody at last had done a decent high-quality study testing something that was regularly done, was going to go straight into guidelines and impact practice. Just as an aside, what's happened since is we've looked carefully at what might have been happening to the brains with some of these new imaging techniques with MRI, and we've learnt some amazing new things about what happens to the brain when it swells and when the brain goes out of the skull and what happens to the fibres, like you can see in this picture with MRI, when they stretch. So it's led to a fascinating new area of research as well as being important clinically. So that's number one. And here's number two, which was a little bit before that. And this is also in critically ill patients with traumatic brain injury. So head injury is a common thing at the Alfred. It's a big problem in Melbourne and on the AMREP campus. And patients who have critical illness and head injuries need resuscitation a lot. And in Australia, for generations, we interchangeably used two fluids to resuscitate people. No one had ever tested it before. So we designed a super trial, let out of some key sites like here at AMREP, around the country, testing in 7,000 patients, resuscitation fluids in critically ill patients. Because we had so many patients in the study, we had a terrific study within that of traumatic brain injury patients. And that was called the SAFE TBI study. It was the first time a large randomised trial had been done testing these fluids. It found that, much to everybody's surprise, that one of the fluids had much lower mortality for the head injury patient specifically than the other one. This hadn't been known before. It completely changed the way we resuscitated people because we immediately stopped using the expensive fluid and used the cheaper one instead, and it translated immediately to our practice in patients, and it generated a whole lot of new work about why that might be this difference in fluids that hadn't been expected before. It's all to do with osmosis and the way fluid goes into the brain, whether it's an albumin colloidal solution or a crystalloid one. And it changed practice internationally because this is the American FDA issuing a warning about one of the fluid that had the worst outcomes compared to the other. So directly impacting to patient practice. And in this case, the cheaper fluid was associated with better outcomes. And then when a independent agency who was contracted by the TAC here in Victoria to work out what the cost effectiveness of this might be, they concluded that switching all these patients in Australia to the cheaper fluid would generate in lifetime costs about $700 million a year to the Australian healthcare system. Interestingly, the study I showed you first, the surgical one, translating that to total practice throughout our country would lead to more than $100 million saved because of the reduced severely dependent survivors. So both of them very important for patients and for outcomes. So they're my two main messages. Clinical research can be very exciting. It can translate in a dramatic way, and it comes out of questions from, in my view, and I think in others, that clinical doctors see in the unit. And if they're clinician scientists, they know how to change those clinical questions into projects that can generate outcomes. So here's our Alfred ICU, where the doctors do the work. And it's very close to the in my case, the ANZIC Research Centre, School of Public Health here, level 6 at Alfred Centre, the corridor between the two, and the doctors and the scientists and the public health doctors interchange all the time. And because of the skills on both campuses, we can get an awful lot done. Thanks very much.